Now we're going to talk to Peter Dow. Pete was one of the top advisors to Hillary Clinton on her presidential run. He also worked for the United Nations Foundation, the Clinton Global Initiative, and the list is just far too long. I'm going to stop right there. And he's written a very interesting article called How a Handful of Liberal Bloggers Are Bringing Down the Obama Presidency. Now, that's a fascinating title. Pete, welcome back to the Young Turks. Oh, good to have you. Tell us your main premise here. How are the liberal bloggers bringing down the Obama presidency?
Well, first, you know, I tried to come up with a title that was relatively open-ended or open to interpretation. So, and that's exactly what happened. It was interpreted in different ways. One way was that the bloggers intentionally want to bring down this presidency, which is not, you know, my premise. But, you know, bringing down could be making them feel bad. Bringing down could be bringing their poll numbers down. So the title was sort of an important part of what I was trying to say. But, you know, essentially what I was trying to point to is that there's a brain trust of bloggers. And I mentioned some, you know, Glenn Greenwald, Digby, et cetera, who have disproportionate influence. I've always argued that Democrats simply don't appreciate the power of the progressive blogosphere. They just have not from day one. And that power is not only do they have, you know, tens and hundreds of thousands of readers, but they form the narratives, the ideas, the themes, the arguments that then filter through the rank and file of Democrats and the Democratic base and progressives and activists, et cetera. So, you know, the argument here is that the principled objections that several of these bloggers have, and I only mentioned a handful, but there are several more than the ones that I mentioned, you know, have essentially affected the president's poll numbers by opposing him or critiquing him on issues like civil liberties, the war in Afghanistan, Gitmo, gay rights, the environment, et cetera. That's the basic theme.
So I have a lot of questions about that, but before we go any further, so do you view that as a bad thing, or do you think, hey, you know, they're trying to keep him honest?
Well, you know, I was really just trying to make an observation, and I started sort of saying this early on in Obama's presidency, which was that everybody expected attacks from the right, and I think his team did as well. And everybody expected the media to look for, you know, the hope bubble has burst and to run with that storyline. But I don't think they expected, neither his team nor I think in general, you know, the punditry in general, expected this to have this level of resistance, you know, among progressives and progressive activists. And so what I think has happened is that confluence of both getting attacked by both sides, I think, has really depressed his poll numbers. So, you know, that, so it really was more an observation of this is what I think is happening, as opposed to a value judgment of whether it's good or bad. Now, there is a value judgment I will make, because, you know, I have been among the bloggers who have done that, and that is to, and I think that our job now is to make the principled critique. He says, hold me accountable. That's our job, I take that job seriously. Our job as citizens, you know, in campaign mode, you cheer and you do your best to win. And then he was elected. And then at that point, you turn over to, you know, you're working for us. And we're going to make sure that we hold you to the standards that we think matter.
You know, some in the blogosphere, of course, are in the other camp and say that Glenn Greenwald, Jane Hampshire, et cetera, they accuse me, David Sirota, of helping the Republicans by doing what you're saying, which is, you know, bringing down Obama's poll numbers, et cetera, and that we should be good soldiers and just, you know, back to president. Do you think it has validity?
I hate to be, you know, dogmatic about it, but I think that's absurd on its face. Because if you take that approach, then you just never criticize your own party, ever, because you're always helping the opposition. There are very serious lapses here. If you think about just the way, and I've written about this a lot, how this administration has essentially disappeared or spiked the Gulf spill. You know, the report came out, the New York Times just reported on it, a panel appointed by the president, you know, has now said that they essentially misled the public, that they lowered the estimates, They would not go with the high estimates. They did it all along as the spill was going and after the spill, saying that oil had all vanished mysteriously, when in fact that's not the case. Quite the opposite. The oil is probably far below the surface on the seabed and can cause destruction for generations. So, you know, that's one example. Another example is targeted assassinations with no trial. They're just killing a U.S. citizen. That's something Glenn has written a lot about. These are serious transgressions, gay rights, you know, going backwards on women's reproductive rights, stupak, et cetera. These are not small things. These are not things you just ignore because you don't want to give some sort of comfort to the opposing party. So if you hold your tongue on that stuff, you know, I don't know how you're being a responsible citizen at that point.
Yeah, and listen, I literally don't know what they want us to do. For example, to go along the lines of what you were saying, Pete, there's two stories out this week. One is that the federal government is saying that privacy does not exist in public places, so they can place a GPS tracking device on your car without your knowledge. Say, well, you're in public, sad day for you, and I'm going to track all of your movements. I'm going to see if you're going to have an affair, if you're going to the porn shop, whatever you're going to, I don't care. I'm going to track it. I don't need a warrant. And then FBI Director Robert Mueller goes in front of Congress and says, I want you to expand the wiretapping laws, as if we weren't doing enough warrantless wiretapping. He says, you know what, I want to be able to tap your Blackberries, your iPhones. I want all these companies to make sure that I can decode their programs, et cetera, so I can have access to it. So I guess my question to them is, what do you want me to do, not report it? Do you want me to lie to the audience and say, oh, no, Obama's awesome on this? I literally don't even I guess they want us to be like Rush Limbaugh and carry the water of the Democratic Party. But I don't see how. I mean, if somebody did that, Pete, wouldn't you lose all respect for them?
Well, that, you know, this is the issue. I mentioned intellectual, consistency and intellectual honesty. Glenn was going after the Bush administration for the same things he's going after the Obama administration. I respect that. If he didn't do that, I would lose respect for him. You know, what people tend to forget, and what is really the most dispiriting and disappointing part of this, is that the things that we were, and when I say we, I say the progressive community and activists, et cetera, and commentators, what we were most alarmed by with Bush are the very things that Obama's doing. It wasn't that he wasn't providing health care. That's not what got us so upset and so worried. It was that he and Cheney were overreaching with executive power, with secrecy, you know, with essentially making unilateral war, indefinite detention. These are the things that the Obama administration is continuing, to the great dismay of progressives. If we kept our mouth shut about it, then we had no principles to begin with when we went after Bush. Our job is to protect the Constitution, protect the principles that we stand for. It doesn't matter which party's doing it. Now, I understand that Democrats are better than Republicans. I understand that. I've worked for Democrats my whole life, you know. And when I say work for them, literally work for Democratic campaigns. I'm not just talking from the outside, and you know that. And you know, both the Kerry campaign, Hillary Clinton's campaign, and several others. But you have to stand up on principle. And my ultimate argument has always been, I think a lot of these bloggers are saying the same thing, when you stand for what you believe in, and when your beliefs are your core ideals, and you really fight for them, you will win politically too. It's a win-win. And I've constantly said that the reason I think Democrats are doing so poorly, and that hope bubble burst so fast, and Bush is now even with Obama in some polls in terms of who people like as president, is because Democrats have a tendency to try to look strong by pitching their values.
Yeah, well, you know, I couldn't agree more with that. We're talking to Peter Dow, one of the top strategists for Hillary Clinton, also worked on John Kerry's campaign, did outreach to bloggers as well. But, you know, one thing I just want to go back to is, do you think that these bloggers are having this enormous effect? And that, you know, I'm not saying I don't agree with that. I'm just not sure. Like, why? What's your evidence that Digby and Greenwald and Hampshire, et cetera, that they're having this big effect? Where do you get that sense?
Well, here's the premise. And you know, again, this is something I've written about in terms of how the communications landscape is changing from the 20th to the 21st century. You know, how social media, digital media, new media, whatever you want to call it, is transforming the nature of communication. What you have is this morphing between traditional media and the online community, where now you have a whole bunch of people who were just reporters who have now become, you know, sort of quasi-reporter bloggers, whether Ben Smith, you know, Jake Tapper, Mark Halperin. you sort of, you know, they're completely in tune with blogs, listen to what blogs are saying, but they're also really come from a traditional reporting background and worked at major publications. So you have this whole morphing of the two that's going on. Bloggers, as I say, are the brain trust. They are the ones who dive into these arguments, look at every possible angle. Many of them are experts. You know, we keep talking about Glenn. You know, he's a lawyer. He understands these issues in real depth. So what happens is it's not just the audience they have. It's who the audience is. The narratives and themes and storylines that filter to local media develop really essentially inside the Beltway with the, I hate using this word, but the elite media, you know, the top pundits, the top reporters, the highest levels of the top outlets. At that level, bloggers are there influencing what they think and believe. So in that way, excuse me, they're inserting these ideas, this resistance to Obama, this critique, into that bloodstream, which is then filtering across the country. So this is why I keep saying it's disproportionate influence. You know, so when Glenn is getting picked up and reported on, whether it's Meet the Press or elsewhere, or is informing these major media outlets, his reach is magnified exponentially.
Well, you know, I'm not sure that I agree with the magnitude of what you're saying, but I hope you're right. I hope that is the case. Because
well, let me just stop you there, Cenk. Here's the thing. There's no doubt. I mean, Ezra Klein is very well connected into this White House. He's a good guy, known him for a very long time. You know, after I wrote the piece, he said, well, you know, whatever Peter says, these bloggers are getting under the White House's skin. Now, you wouldn't get under the White House's skin if what you were doing didn't matter. And the corollary to that is all these people who come after you and Glenn and Jane and Digby and John Aravosis, et cetera, wouldn't be so upset if they didn't think somehow these people were making a difference. So all the evidence points to people are very concerned about what these bloggers are saying. So just go from the circumstantial evidence, and I think my case might be able to be made that way.
Well, like I said, I hope to God you're right. So, Peter Dowd, thanks so much for joining us. Really appreciate it.
It's my pleasure. Thanks.